Down in the valley with my Savior I would go, where the flowers are blooming and the sweet waters flow. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow, follow on, walking in His footsteps till the crown be won.
Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. His hands to lead me, I will never, never fear. Danger cannot frighten me if my Lord is near.
Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow on.
Down in the valley or up on the mountain steep, close beside my Savior will my soul ever keep. He will lead me safely in the path that He has trod, up to where they gather on the hills of God.
Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Anywhere, everywhere, I will follow on. Follow, follow, I will follow Jesus. Everywhere He leads me, I will follow on.
Me, I will follow on. And those of you been listening to the news, they had a shooting down in Texas. One guy shot, killed 20 people and wounded 25. I heard the governor of Texas say today, this morning, they kick out God and bring in video games. And that's the result. Anybody playing video games? Throw them out. It's an abomination. But it could be successful because one kid made $3 million playing video games on a worldwide game operation. But he had to stick in 8 to 9 hours a day playing. Can you imagine? His brain must be growing smaller by the day and his fingers growing by the hour. When I watch video games, when I even watch TV, whatever you watch, you're consumed with after a while. And this is what's happening. They want to outlaw guns. The governor said, we've had guns since Texas existed. Of course, they had problems, but a kid, a 20-year-old kid, going into a Walmart and just start shooting people. Doesn't matter if it's a 6-year-old child or a grandmother. The guy must be crazy in the head and full of the devil. They should bring back the guillotine, you know, where they do public executions. That would take care of it and maybe do it publicly on Main Street. But we'll see how God is going to handle that. For those of you who are here in the last couple of Sundays, I've been preaching on assurance of salvation. And it's an interesting subject. The question I have today is this. Your assurance, is it a revelation or have you been taught? Is it information for you? There's a difference. Revelation When God hits you with the revelation, you know that you know that he spoke to you. It passes from here to here the moment the second God reveals something. Then, for some reason, regardless who argues with you, they can't argue out of it. That's when God put his stamp on you. And you know then that you know. The Bible teaches us, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ for your salvation. But there's some matching scriptures that have to jive with that one. And you study the Word of God, and if it all clicks into place like a puzzle, then you know that you have it. And today I'll teach on that, how it works, what, and how sure your salvation is. Because there's so many Christians out there. I wonder if I'm really saved. I wonder if I'm good enough for God. I messed up yesterday. Of course, and you'll mess up tomorrow. God doesn't look only. The Bible doesn't teach us something. All our righteousness are as filthy rags. When we try to somehow please God, he knows the intents of our hearts. If we're not in Christ Jesus, our righteousness count for nothing. You got to be born again. You've got to become a new creation in Christ. And this is what salvation means. Becoming something new. Not just believing something, but becoming part of it. And once you're part of it, nothing can separate you. So before we get into this message today, let's rise and ask the Lord for blessing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your grace, and we ask you, God, that you will open our hearts today to the simplicity of Scripture. Help us to understand and see that we may rejoice in what we have. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. There's an interesting scripture where the Apostle Paul and Silas were in prison. And for those of us who read the scripture, we come to this place where the jailer, who was fearing for his life, cried out and said, "What must I do to be saved?" And Paul said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved." Now, that's a pretty vague answer, but the Bible teaches that the jailer and his whole household believed and got saved, and they were all baptized. And we need to understand there is a deep meaning of believing. In John chapter 1, it tells us, "Those that believe in Jesus, to them give he the power to become the sons of God." So what is he getting at here? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15 in verse 1, it says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I have preached unto you, which also you have received, wherein you stand." He says, "I preach unto you this gospel which you have received, wherein you stand, which by which you are saved, if you keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless you believe in vain. For I delivered unto you, first of all, that which I also received." So the Apostle Paul tells them, "I'm getting saved the same way in which I'm telling you how to get saved. I'm included in this. For I deliver unto you, first of all, that which I have received. Now that Christ died for our sins according to Scripture, and he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to Scripture." The sacrificial lamb has been sent. We know that Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, they fell into sin, and we inherited that sin nature. But God said, I will send somebody that'll straighten this mess out. And Jesus, after 4,000 years, came along and he paid the penalty for our sin. He became our scapegoat. He became our sacrificial lamb so that we can now stand at peace and look God in the face and tell him, yes, I've been cleansed by the sacrifice. That's interesting. Nobody, like my son-in-law told me yesterday, he said, I'm only as holy and clean as the blood of Jesus can make me. That's an interesting one. That's an interesting one. I'm only as holy and clean as the blood of Jesus can make me. And how holy and clean is that? That's perfect. That's pure. That's holy. And that's for keeps. Hallelujah. In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, in verse 22, listen to this one. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Is the whole world saved? There are people, alas, some of them whom I've used to call be friends of mine, who tell us that everybody is saved. Every human being on this earth, there is an organization, there's a church system out there that goes and preaches that everybody is saved. I guess they use this scripture, as in Adam all die, of course. In Adam we all lost our fellowship with God. But if you're in, now listen, there's a little word there that you have to pay attention to. Even so, in Christ shall all be made alive. If you're in Christ, very interesting. Yes, the world was cleansed from its iniquities. Yes, the world was given a chance to come back to God again. For Jesus, by one offering, he forever sanctified them that are called. So by one offering, he cleansed the whole world. For God so loved the world, it doesn't say the church, it says the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, for those who believe in him shall not perish. Listen to that. For in Adam all die, but so in Christ shall all be made alive. That little word in, you have to be in Christ. And how does that work? You have to become born again. Many will argue everybody is saved, and I've heard them over the internet. Everybody's saved. Listen to this in John chapter 5. Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice and shall come forth. They that have done good unto resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. So there is a place called the eternal lake of fire. There are two places, two eternal lives, you can say. You got your choice to make when you're here on this earth. You look at this world, you live to be about, now it seems to be people are getting to be 90 more and more. I'm getting close to 70 years old. And I'm looking ahead and I'm saying, wow, this life went fast. What else can I accomplish? Not much. I'm going to be 70, 80 pretty soon. What can you do with a 75-year-old body? You can't accomplish too much. So it's going downhill for me as far as this physical world is concerned. I'm losing steam. I'm running out of energy. That's that's how everybody is on this planet. The one time you reach 65, they give you some money to keep you going for a while, hoping you'll die. But you're running out of time. And here is what happens. Did you make the right choice? Why are you here on this earth? To become a millionaire? What? If you're 70, 80 years old, not too long ago, a billionaire died, 65 years old. All his billions for nothing. Somebody else will take it. What are we here for? It's to make a choice where we're going to spend that eternity. And God has put the ball in our field. It's you that has to make that choice. Are you going to spend it with God, or are you going to spend it apart from God? Today is the day of your salvation. Don't wait for tomorrow. Harden not your heart, for today is when God is knocking. For those listening by the internet, you need to understand there's not much chance left. Those people that went to the Walmart yesterday never thought of anything. We got to go and buy this stuff that we want. We got to go and buy. And as they were walking out, this gunman walks in, starts shooting him left and right. Didn't know, matter what age they were, grandmother, little children. And there's 20 dead in a matter of a few minutes. The guy couldn't care less. He didn't even shoot himself. He didn't have the guts. The police took him alive. Now, where are those people? They were alive and well yesterday morning. In the evening, they were in eternity. Eternity where? If they were with God, good. The gunman did them a favor, except for the poor loved ones that are behind. But if they weren't with God, if they weren't saved, they're forever in eternity, never again to get a chance at this shot at eternal life. 1 John chapter 5 in verse 1, it tells us, whosoever ever believed that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Now there's an interesting little scripture. Whosoever that believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. You have to remember the word Christ means the Savior. Whosoever believes that Jesus is his Savior is born of God. And everyone that loves him that beget, loveth also him that is begotten of him. The Muslim system, the Muslim belief, they pray this prayer, there's only one God and he has no son. Sorry. Here it tells us, those that love the one that is begotten also love the one that begat him. And who begat him? It's the Father. It's the Son. They work together. Hallelujah. If you love one, you have to love the other. If you make a distinction, you got a problem. If you make a distinction, there is no God, you got a problem. Jesus and the Father and the Holy Spirit, they're all three in one, but they're also three different characters. So if you believe that Jesus is the Savior, you're born. You believe it for yourself. Interesting. You then spend your eternity with God. Now listen to this. We're getting down to the place where it'll show us. We can know that within our hearts. It's not just something that's vague. We can experience it. We can have it in ourselves. We can be part of it. Not only believe it, but be part of it. For whosoever is born of God overcomes the world. Remember Revelations chapter 2, where Jesus talks about the churches. He that overcomes, to them will I give a new name. He that overcomes, I will make him a pillar in my Father's house. What's an overcomer? For whosoever is born of God overcomes the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. Our faith in what Jesus did for us at the cross of Calvary. Whosoever is that overcomes the world, but he that believes that Jesus is the Son of God, that works all together here. Interesting. If you only study it for a little bit and take it to heart, your revelation will come, and you will know that you belong to God. In 1 John chapter 5 in verse 10, he that believes on the Son of God has to witness in himself. Listen to this one. He that believes not God has made him a liar. Now, here is where I sometimes wonder how many Christians study the scripture. He that believes on the Son of God has to witness in himself. He that believes not God has made him a liar, because he believes not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God has given to us, eternal life, and this life is in his Son. In other words, where does eternal life begin? When you're in heaven? No, your geographical location doesn't determine whether you belong to God. Your eternal life begins the moment you become a new creation in Christ Jesus. And when does that happen? When you accept Jesus as your Savior. That's when your eternal life begins. And how long will that eternal life last? Exactly what it says, eternal. And if you do not believe that, the Bible says you make God a liar. So if you believe in once saved, always saved, or eternal security, is it information that you have, or is it revelation? There is a big difference. Because if you only have information of what I teach you, then you will doubt. And somebody else will come along and say, I don't think it's like that. But if God shows you that's revelation, then nobody can talk you out of it, regardless what they try. This is what I like about Scripture. You study, you read, and you'll come to a scripture and it'll hit you in the face like a bolt of lightning. That's what I call revelation. That's when you know that God had spoken to you. It says, this is the record that God has given us, eternal life, and this life is in his Son. 1 John chapter 5 in verse 12, he that has the Son has life. He that has not the Son of God has not life. Now listen to this. These things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know, not hope so. I like old Perry F. Rockwood. Not hope so, not think so, not wish so. That's what he used to say over and over. He says, that you may know. Scripture teaches that you may know that you have eternal life and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. This is what Scripture teaches us. This is what revelation I got when I first became a Christian, and I have never looked back. All the naysayers quieting down after a while when they see that you're consistent. You don't change your mind every 10 minutes. You're consistent, because the reason you're consistent is because God has shown you. You do not have to change your mind. You know in your heart that you're right. I'm only speaking for myself. I know that I know that I'm going to heaven. And you have to know that for yourself. I can't make that choice for you. And listen to this here. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and verse 22. If any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be damned. That's what this I can never pronounce that word, but you get the drift. Anathema. Maranatha, that means the Lord is coming. I'll make it plain English. If any man love not the Lord Jesus Christ, let him be damned. That's what it means. Let him be damned. Maranatha, the Lord is coming. That's what the Bible says. So where do you stand on this? And then one more scripture is this, 1 John chapter 2. They went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would no doubt have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that they were not of us. That's what scripture teaches. The reason they leave is because they never truly were born again. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this service, Lord, for this message, that we can turn to you and be assured, because we are not those that are going to draw back. If we know that we know, this is what we got, and nobody can take it from us. Let the Lord open your heart to this and make you a blessing. Amen.
I just love that good old gospel singing.
I'll Fly Away is my favorite song.
I just love that good old time religion.
This old world is gone much too long. Oh, how I love to sing and tell when they ring those golden bells. And I just can't stand in one place when they sing Amazing Grace.
I just love that good old country preaching.
This old world has gone without it much too long.
Yes, I love them good old
love.